Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Stephanie Desmon talks to Johns Hopkins vaccine experts Anna Durbin and Bill Moss. They discuss what's next for COVID vaccines, from different formulations beyond mRNA to the development of vaccines that could be administered up your nose. And the big question, why do we need more vaccines? Let's listen.
Anna Durbin and Bill Moss, thanks so much for joining me.
Sure, it's my pleasure.
Thank you, Stephanie.
And I wanted to start with you. Today, we're going to talk about vaccines, give a little update on where we are. And I guess my question is this. I keep reading about there's a Novavax vaccine. There's a GlaxoSmithKline Sanofi vaccine. Peter Hotez at Baylor College has a vaccine. Why do we need more vaccines?
That's a great question, Stephanie. And I'll say we need more vaccines for a couple of reasons. One, it's important to remember we're vaccinating the world and we need more vaccines to meet that demand. But I think it's also important to note that there are some people who the current vaccines may not be the best for or just may not feel comfortable taking those vaccines. We still see, you know, some hesitancy around the mRNA vaccines because it's a new technology. And I've had patients and people in the community say to me, oh, you know, the Novavax vaccine, that looks really good, or the Sanofi vaccine, because it's a platform or technology that has been used for other vaccines historically. So they're just more comfortable with it. The nice thing I also think is that, and we'll probably get more data on this in the future, is if some vaccines aren't available, for instance, for a second dose or for a booster dose, the mix and match, you may be able to then have a greater selection or a greater variety if there's some production delays or something and you may not have enough vaccine of the one that you originally got. So I don't think it's a bad idea to have more vaccines. I think, you know, we're still waiting for some data to come out. But the more vaccines we have that people are willing to take, the better off we're going to be.
Mm-hmm. So I guess also there's a sort of a second generation of vaccines that are being developed, Anna.
Yeah, I think that is really important to note. So we've had a lot of different variants over the past 2 years. We know the Omicron variant is what we would call the most divergent or different. And because of that, we need much higher antibody titers to prevent infection with Omicron. And so having sort of strain-specific variant vaccines or vaccines that most closely resemble the latest variant, I think is an important advance. I mean, if you think about it, we do this every year with the flu vaccine. We sort of match the vaccine to the current circulating strains. I'm not saying that that's where we're going with COVID vaccines, but I do think it's important now that we know that Omicron is the dominant variant, that we're seeing it globally as the dominant variant. It's important, I think, to have a vaccine that is specific for that, because it may be if you have an Omicron-specific vaccine, the antibodies that you make or the immune response that you make is more targeted to that, and you may get more durable, better protection in the long run.
Bill, I hear what she's saying about second generation vaccines and talking about the Omicron variant, but we have gone through variants like this so quickly. So I'm wondering if we could miss the boat if we focus on those.
Well, that's possible. It is possible that there will be the emergence of a new variant that can escape immunity from, you know, from a vaccine that was based on the original variant or the original version of the virus, like our current mRNA vaccines and Omicron. I think that becomes less likely going forward because there are evolutionary constraints on the virus. The virus, the spike protein of the virus to which our immune protective immune responses are directed, has to be able to bind to our cellular receptors in order for the virus to get into the cell and replicate. And so it can only change too much. If that spike protein really mutates wildly, viruses are not going to be able to enter our cells sufficiently. So there are constraints, but it is possible. I mean, that's the wild card here, I think, is whether, you know, there's going to be the emergence of a new variant that really can escape not only immunity from earlier variants, but also from Omicron. But I'll just add, Stephanie, that, you know, to build on some of the things that Anna said, you know, the vaccines we were talking about, the Sanofi GSK, the Novavax, the Corbevax vaccine from Baylor, those are all protein-based vaccines. And so there are advantages, you know, some advantages in terms of manufacturing and storage and transport of protein-based vaccines over some of, say, the mRNA vaccines. Those are technologies that, as Anna said, you know, have been around for probably around 100 years, you know, using protein-based vaccines. There are manufacturing capabilities to build those kinds of vaccines around the world. And they may be, they don't require that kind of ultra-cold storage that the mRNA vaccines. But there are a couple vaccine delivery platforms that I'm kind of excited about to at least watch. You know, there are a number of companies working on intranasal or mucosal vaccines. Those have the potential to be more effective at protecting against infection. And we've seen declining vaccine efficacy against infection and mild disease with our current vaccines. Another one, there's been some talk about a pan-coronavirus vaccine. I don't think that's on the immediate horizon, but that would be ideal. Targeting some conserved areas of control of coronaviruses, so we don't need to kind of update our vaccine, you know, regularly with new variants. Another technology that I've been watching in the measles field that I'm very interested in are what we call microarray patches, where you deliver the vaccine on a patch on the skin, almost like putting a Band-Aid on and taking it off. And there are companies working on that. I think that's actually the vaccine delivery form of the future. And so I'm hoping that COVID-19 vaccines will accelerate that.
Those all sound actually very interesting. I think we could do a podcast on each one of those. Bill, I've been thinking a lot about sort of the vaccine, the Chinese vaccine, the Sinopharm, and the Russian vaccine, the Sputnik. And I know there are countries where that is their main source of vaccine. And I'm wondering, do we know enough about how effective those are or are not, and whether we're going to really need to send new vaccine to those countries?
Yes, that's a great question. And we do have more and more data on the effectiveness of some of these other vaccines. Some of the Chinese manufactured vaccines are inactivated vaccines, and they have not had the level of effectiveness that we've seen with the mRNA or the adenovirus vectored vaccines. It's really interesting to me, Stephanie, you know, when you look at the disease burden in, for example, sub-Saharan Africa, where I have a lot of friends and colleagues, it still is remarkably low. And the question is why? And, you know, is some of this is probably underreporting and surveillance systems, but they just do not seem to have had their health systems kind of overwhelmed like we have in the United States with severe cases. So I say that because despite the fact that the vaccines that have been used in some of these countries appear to have lower vaccine effectiveness, we have not seen the terrible consequences that one might predict because of that. When I think about, you know, rolling out these COVID-19 vaccines in countries in sub-Saharan Africa, for example, I often think of the 4 Ds. And Stephanie, I have to say, I wanted to get these 4 Ds in. Doses, delivery, demand, and data as kind of the system that one needs. One needs to have sufficient doses and doses of effective vaccines, no doubt about that. But one needs to also be able to deliver those doses once they're in country, get them into the arms of people who need them. And many countries have struggled with this. This is a different target population, adults. They can do it very effectively for children through childhood immunization programs, but they struggle to get the vaccines into adults. They have to have the demand. And I think for these COVID-19 vaccines, we've seen decreased demand in countries. Let's say I'm using Sub-Saharan Africa as an example, where we never saw that level of vaccine hesitancy for childhood vaccines. And that's for, you know, multiple different reasons. And then countries need to have the data to be able to track who's getting these vaccines and whether they need second or third doses. So it's very complex. But you're right to raise the issue of, you know, the vaccine effectiveness of the vaccines that they're using. Is that a problem? And will they need to revaccinate? I would certainly say yes. If we start seeing, coming back to Anna's point earlier, the metric will be increased hospitalizations and severe disease among individuals who were previously vaccinated. That's kind of the red line for me, where we really need to make changes in our vaccination strategies and perhaps the vaccines that are being used.
U.S. isn't doing so great in terms of percentage of people being vaccinated. Is there more we can do with that?
I wish there were, Stephanie, but you're exactly right. We've seen a real plateauing of the number of people, of unvaccinated people getting first doses or second doses. We've seen a plateauing in booster doses. And to be honest with you, I'm not optimistic that we're going to be able to move the needle much on that. The way I think about that is it falls into two broad categories: access to vaccines and demand for vaccines. I think we've done a good job on access. There's probably more that can be done. The CDC recently issued a report showing disparities in vaccine coverage, with rural areas having much lower coverage than urban areas. There are multiple factors that contribute to that. But I think we could do a better job at increasing access for some of our populations here in the United States. I'm reminded of an effort being undertaken in Sindh province in Pakistan, where they're training 13,000 women to go door to door. And they're building off their experience with polio campaigns and other vaccination campaigns. That's the way you really, I mean, that's a huge effort, but that's how you improve access. You bring vaccines to people. But that's not going to completely solve the problem in the United States, because it's not all an access problem. In fact, I think that's probably a smaller proportion of the problem. It's really a demand problem. And it's really hard to say that at this point, as cases, hospitalizations, and deaths are coming down, that we're really going to be able to convince those who are currently unvaccinated and have had access to vaccines to actually get vaccinated.
And Anna, I wanted to sort of finish with you. We are absolutely in a different place than we were 2 years ago, a different place than we were 1 year ago. What do you see as the vaccine picture going forward?
That's a great question, Stephanie. And when I talk to people, I always like to say, now, I think we really have to manage our expectations. What is the future? And I think, you know, the first message I want to get across is that COVID will not go away. It's not going to disappear. It's going to be with us, I think, for the indefinite future, perhaps, you know, for years. It may become another seasonal cold virus like we already have, but it's not going to go away. And we're going to continue to have positive cases. That does not mean we've lost the battle by any stretch of the imagination. What we've seen now is that you can prevent hospitalizations, you can prevent severe disease. So we may be living with COVID, but I think we can live, I don't want to say so much in harmony, but we can have pretty normal lives with COVID. I think it's still important, though, to try to prevent spread, just as you would with the flu or with another cold virus. So wash your hands, continue to wash your hands. I wear a mask to the grocery store or crowded places still, because I haven't had a cold in 2 years and I don't want to get one. But I do think it's important to just keep in mind COVID's not going to go away. It's going to be there. You're going to see cases, positive cases, but we are in a much, much better place.
Anna Durbin and Bill Moss, thanks so much for joining me.
Thank you, Stephanie.
Thanks, Stephanie.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.